Hey, welcome. This is Academy of Tone number 63. Huh. And today I'm all by myself here in the studio, except for the camera guy, because Rich, who is originally planned to be on this episode, the Englander, has to watch television. He has to watch the game of England versus Denmark. So that's a weird thing. But anyway, all good. I wonder what Danish Pete is doing today. I mean, Danish Pete, maybe you know him from Endertons. He is Danish, living in the UK. He might have a problem. Either way, he has a problem. If England wins, his Danish soul will suffer. If Denmark wins, you know, his new home country will suffer. Anyway, it's a special day today. Okay, I came up with the idea of this episode since I had a phone call just the other day from the US. A guy called Rick asked me about some sounds, and he was very interested in certain details. And he found a few sounds on the AMP1, but then on the other hand, I had a feeling like, you know what, there's a lot of information that I have which is not common ground, which I would like to share with you guys. And it's kind of the next level. If you look at classic amps like, you know, the good old Marshalls or Fender, we are quite familiar with the way how we set those up. I mean, you know, if there's a, for instance, in the last episode, we had a GCM 800. If you put everything on 7, you can't go wrong. That's a pretty good setting on a GCM 800 to start with. And if you have like a Fender amp, you know the bass is kind of a bass on and off switch from 2 to 3. So 2.5 is kind of where the bass is nice. And if it's on 3 and 4, it's sometimes too much. And if it's on 2, it's kind of not there anymore. This, you know, these amps have been around for ages, so everybody knows a bit how to set those up because they are classics, and the knowledge how to set these amps is kind of around for decades. And then of course there are more difficult amps or amps with more options or more specials, and like Mesa Boogies, and not everybody gets along with these nicely because they have maybe too many options. And me, with designing the AMP1 and the Blue Guitar products, I always come back to the idea of having a simple layout which I can still operate in a live situation, because when it's live, I don't want to have too many knobs in front of me. So here's just my classic 3-band tone control, bass, mid, treble, the reverb, master for the overdrive channels, and clean volume. And that's it. All the rest is kind of the stuff that I'm not touching in a live situation. That's the custom control. Maybe we can show that. The custom control on the side here, that's where we can tweak the sounds, but I wouldn't do that on stage. This is something we would do at home and prepare ourselves with our sounds. The idea behind my concept is, if anything needs a quick access, it's right there at the top. This is the main important things on stage, but there's a lot more under the hood. And this is what I want to talk about today. A few things are general and can apply to many amps, not every amp, but many amps, as of course there are similarities. And other things are special with the AMP1, but it doesn't matter. You know, maybe you can follow my thinking a little bit. You know, in the last episode, I had this JCM 800 when Ollie was there, and it, because I like the sound, I have it in my head. So for me, it's a very easy one to tweak the AMP-1 towards that sound. First, because I kind of have that 800 sound already in my AMP-1. And second, it's easy to find because it's kind of in the center of what's the AMP-1. But there's lots more. First, I would like to show you a few different traditional settings. And in the announcement, I was talking about, you know, bright, sparkling cleans for single coils and humbuckers. And let me show how I could achieve that. When I was playing that song at the beginning, I started with program number one on my remote here, which is, this is one. And yeah, what I was using is the clean channel with a boost, but the boost is kind of set too low. This gives me, with this guitar, yeah, that's kind of a nice and spanky clean tone. And by the way, this is the Otti Fanten guitar for the Germans. They know the comedian Otto Walkes. Yeah, this is the one that he signed for me and my niece Leonie, who did the aging on that guitar. By the way, so this is kind of a pretty new guitar. It's about a few months old, and it's, yeah. I didn't want to use the 61 original, which is just behind me. It's a great guitar too, but maybe even the better guitar because I played it for the last 40 years. not 30 some. I'm not that old, by the way. I'm old, but not that old. Yeah, so there's this kind of nice and spanky clean tone, if you want that tone. Okay, let me explain what my settings are. I put the EQ, everything on 5. 5 bass, 5 middle, 5 treble. Why? Because that's another way how to change the overall character of the amp to adjust to your cabinet, to the room, to whatever. And having the option to change the overall character is a great thing. First, once we have dialed in the typical tone I'm looking for. Okay, so here is the recipe for clean, spanky clean. I use the clean tone on maximum. So clean tone on maximum is like this. Clean tone on minimum is like that. Maximum again. Okay, I call that maximum is the silver face setting. In the middle, it's kind of a nice black face setting. And on the minimum is more or less a tweed setting. So just to hear the middle position. Thank you. Minimum. Yeah. To me, there is a lot of tonal character only in the tone control of the clean. So if you haven't tried that out, give it a try. So the next very important tonal control is the clean volume. And that goes back to the good old Fender amps with the so-called bright switch. If you have a Fender amp with that bright switch on, you will notice that if you go on a low setting, like 1, 2, 3, the amp is dead clean and the bright switch will give you a lot of sparkle and spanky sounds. Let me do the same here on the amp 1. I put that now, so let me show you to the camera. I put that thing on like 2.5, just for fun. I give it more master volume, which will, it's like a Fender amp is anyhow, because there is no master volume on a clean Fender amp. There's your spanky tone. Okay, if versus I crank it to 7, reduce the master, so we have the same volume. So that's a lot warmer. Okay, let me explain you this treble bleed function, which I also have in my guitar, and I talked about this in Academy of Tone episode number 2. Actually, you should re-watch that episode, because there is so much information in that. When I started the live stream with Academy of Tone, I thought, yeah, I need to think of that, blah, blah, blah. So I packed shitloads of knowledge into some of the early episodes. So it's worth to go back for episode whatever, the first ones in general. They are killer too. Can we show the graph of the treble bleed? Let me explain. So with this graph, you can see on the one side, there's the F, which means frequency. I made a very, very simple graph here, which says like 100 hertz, 500 hertz, 1 kilohertz, 2.5 kilohertz, and double it up to 20 kilohertz. That's kind of the horizontal way. And then in the other direction, we have volume, and the volume goes from 1 to 10. And just imagine that top line, which is now on 10, would decrease. What you would get is the signal below the top line. And if you decrease the top line, that blue line which says treble will stay there. So the lower the top line gets, the more treble you get. Can you imagine that line going lower? Like in the middle, like on 5, you have like flat frequencies in the low range, but then there's a treble boost, you know, starting with like 2.5K up to, you know, top end. Of course, there's a roll-off in guitar amps, so it's not endless, but you get the picture. And if you go even lower on 3, this treble boost is even stronger. And that blue line can be moved from like 1K down to 500 hertz or to 5K. That's the value of that capacitor. And once that value is smaller, it goes up in frequency. Once that value is bigger, it goes lower. And that's a matter of taste, of course, but that's what you find in a treble bleed on the guitar, or like on a bright function in an amplifier. And this is what you get also on the amp 1 in the clean volume. So the clean volume has exactly that function. Maybe we listen again. So I give you 10, and then I switch off the boost for now, so we know it's only coming from this control here. That's it's nice and warm. Let me go down to 5 and compensate with the master. There's a lot more sparkle. And then if I go even lower on 3, it's getting more and more spanky. You know, and back to 10. So, most of the times I get to complain like, oh, my clean tone is muddy and it's woofy and wooly. Like this. No definition. There's a very simple, the super simplest way to get to a defined clean tone is lower the volume, the clean volume, just like on a Fender amp. Give it more master volume. All good. So now we are on whatever, 5 or 6. 6 to 7 is something that I like with a Strat. And just for fun, let's grab some humbucker guitar. I haven't played my beautiful ES-335 for a while. And we listen to that. So that guitar has a bit more output. Let's reduce it. Put it to 5 and super. Okay, you understood the treble bleed or the bright switch, which is in the clean channel. And we understood there's a custom control that gives you that kind of 3 directions. Tweed, warmth, in the middle, blackface, and on full off, on all the way up, we get kind of a silverface clean tone. And now comes my trick with the boost. If I use the boost, let me put the boost to minimum. So boost is all the way down. Absolutely minimum on the amp. So I have the boost on minimum. So this is no boost. And now boost on. There's some kind of nice sparkle. Off to compare. So what's going on here? Is this an EQ? Well, no, it's more overtones. Without. This kind of enhanced treble is more overtones than frequency boost. And that comes with that extra boost stage, which is tube-like, being non-tube. But you know, that's my game. It's all on Amp1 is about tube sound without having too many tubes. There is one. Can we hear it? A little feedback. Yeah. So compared to none. So here's our microphonic tube master volume 9, which will usually kill every human being in the close to a speaker connected to this amp. So anyway, so what I'm saying here is that this tube is real and it's really working and it's high plate voltage and all the whole 9 yards, but it is not really microphonic. It is as microphonic as it's is by nature, but it's super low microphonics, so no problem here. And by the way, I have to repeat this 1,000 times too. This, the lifespan of the tube is by Russian military specs, because this is a Russian military tube, or a tube that is has been used by Russian military, but the spec is, I don't know, 500,000 hours or something, which means we will be all dead and the tube is still alive. So no worries. Directly soldered to the PCB. Forget that tube. You can kill the amp, but the tube will be still alive. And we have some spare tubes, but we actually never, ever had to change a tube due to any wearing. So forget it. And the tech I'm working with, he is about 60 some years, and he knows that tube from his childhood state, the Russian engineer I'm working with, and it's the most reliable tube that we know. Anyway, and going back to the tone again, here is that extra sparkle. No sparkle, and here gives you a little extra boost. Going back, or maybe have the Les Paul for... it's still upstairs, who cares? I had the Les Paul last episode. We'll have it next one again. My good old gold top. Cheers. Mm-hmm. Summer drink. Yeah, let's go back for my Stradivarius. No, let's have the blue guitar just for fun. And here we are. The same thing with the Strat. Something is missing. So I put it to 7. And here's the full body of the guitar. And that's why I did all that stuff. I can make the Les Paul or the 335 or a humbucker sound nice and transparent. And I can do the same with a Strat. And by the way, if you take out more low end and make it thinner, it will not work in the bend context anymore. All that stuff that is here, including the mids, is missing. Is needed. If it's not there, it's missing for a proper guitar sound. I take out the mids here with that control. That kind of sound is lost in the mix. It sounds maybe cool by itself, but once I have some other frequencies, you need that. So trust me, I've been there. I heard my guitar sounds in mixes, in the band, and on recordings. So that's kind of a proven thing here. And if you want to do crazy effect stuff, feel free and do some weird shit with that tone control or whatever. You can have whatever extra equalizers and go crazy with those. There's many options for experimental stuff, but it's not something that will usually work in a context. Okay. This is the clean channel. The next thing I've done when I was playing that song, I switched to program number 6. And there I have the vintage channel, but guitar is on 10, everything on 10. And it's like, rich, clean tone coming from the vintage channel, and the gain is on 8. How is this working? Well, this is using the low gain mode. What the fuck is the low gain mode? Well, if we look at an amplifier, we can see there's a preamp stage, there's a power amp stage, and the preamp stage has several stages internally. Let me show you the graph of the amp one, which is the, how did we call it? The signal flow. And I will explain a little bit about the structure of the internal amp. So in this picture, you see the input, then you see the boost stage with the custom control on top. And then there's this kind of yellowish gain. And that's actually where I was now just active doing a low gain mode, performing a low gain mode. Then we can see two controls that go, it's the clean volume that goes in the clean channel, blah, blah, blah. You know what? We have another thing that shows only the preamp section. Can we see that for a second? Amp one preamp signal flow. So this is bigger now. Okay, input, we see the boost section. So the boost we explained and the level, I was using the level on the lowest setting for this extra sparkle at the moment. And then we can see this gain thing. And this gain thing can be accessed with a remote one, or we can have a fixed value for each channel programmed into the amp one. By default, I have set a certain value there, and the low gain mode can be activated. But you can actually change that value to any value that you like with a remote or with some MIDI device sending MIDI commands. But now I want to talk more about tone here. Maybe I can show you again. Guitar on 10. Compare the whole thing to the clean channel. So it's kind of shocking. The vintage sounds even better on clean than the clean, huh? And what we got now is what Erik de Jong from the Netherlands created as the phrase, the zero gain mode. I put the gain for vintage on that preset number 6 to 0 and left the gain at 8, where I liked it for all my other tones. So let me switch to program number 2, which is the same channel, but without the low gain mode or the zero gain mode. There's my clean tone with the flick of a switch. Easy. And I still have anything in between. If I use the remote, I could have any gain from like zero to maximum, any step in between with this control here. Let me show you. I put it on the gain function. Zero gain. A bit more. So, this is all in your amp 1, hidden under low gain, and it can be adjusted with the remote one, or it can be adjusted via MIDI. You can recall the setting. Of course, we can also use that gain control here, but it sounds different. Let me show you. I put it on maximum here. And I turn down on the gain here. And this control here has again the treble bleed, the extra treble enhancer when you dial the tones lower. So this is full gain, of course. By the way, I'm playing my Hendrix next Saturday. I have to get in the mood for that. But this sound is actually, it's right there. Just put everything on 10 on the vintage channel and you are instant Hendrix. I love it. And the volume control on guitar. Hey, this is, again, every time I play my amp, I think everything is right. Anyway, go back to the sound now. Let's do it here. Versus, let's do it here. Aha, so that sounds different from this one here. So the gain on the amp sounds different from using the gain on the remote. And now this is that next level where we can get into the details. Everybody tells you the tone is in the fingers, but you have to connect to your tone so that your fingers feel right. And exactly here is where the magic starts, where you have to find the best, well, portion of treble and mids, whatever. And it can be done in the mixture of the two. You can find your sweet spot. It's about that sweet spot. You have to connect to the guitar string under your fingertips. And that's when the frequencies are right. And I'm not touching the post-EQ. I'm just talking about gain, which is kind of the amount of gain and the style of pre-EQ where so many things happen. And if this is too bright for you, which is nice for like Vox AC30 styles, if you want the same thing warmer, put in more gain here, like 6, and reduces here. And even warmer, which means more gain here, less here. With this function, I can get almost everywhere. And that works not only on your clean channel, that works not only on your vintage channel, that also works on the classic and the modern channels. So, for instance, I have another preset here, which is 8, using the classic channel, but again, low gain mode, which means... versus vintage, now with the boost. For fun, I give it more boost now. And that's another great tone. By the way, today I'm only on 10 on my guitar. So my usual trick with using the treble bleed on the guitar, which is another whole universe, is not even what I'm doing today. I want to just show you what I can do with the kind of treble bleeds and these functions on the amp 1. How many different tones we get out of that combination. So, this was vintage, and now classic. Classic, no boost, and you can hear it's kind of woodier. Just for fun, I go to the regular classic with no low gain mode, which means as this control is set gain to 8 now, which is that sound. From cleanish or bluesy in the classic channel to the typical rock classic tone. And just for fun, I did another preset on the 9, which is using the classic with reduced gain, but the boost on top, which gives you a nice balance of the woodiness plus some extra bite from the boost. And so let's listen to that kind of combination here. Killer sustain. Why? Because I have brought in the extra boost stage, but not having too much gain. It's more about having extra, yeah, an extra stage that does extra pushing. And this is what we hear. It has, you know, it has all the dynamics. You know, I can play clean just by softly hitting the strings. And then if I would use my volume control, which I usually do, but I try not to today, I get even more toned. I'm liking that, classic with a little boost on top of that. Okay, and then I had the modern channel here, which is standard modern with no low gain mode, because now we want more gain and modern as it is. Okay, and there is modern and the boosts. So how much more gain do we want? I mean, there's still a little bit on tap on the gain control, because we are only at 7 and the boost is not all the way up, but you can, I mean, this is a single coil strat and we have tons of gain. Like, but great tone. Okay, so what is the message here? I wasn't even touching the three-band tone control and I could get all those different tones out of the four channels using different settings on the volume and the gain coming from the remote one. The remote one or any MIDI controller, if you have like a Helix, you can send the same information that is coming from a remote one and you get to the same results. It's just using that extra gain stage setting option that we have in the Amp One. Okay. I look at some questions here. And then we can answer a few. Okay, Mats Lang, who needs low gain? Haha, yeah, of course. Some, if you are a high gain player, nobody needs low gain. Poo Ninja, hi there, guys, again. Does the gate track the input for a trigger or? Yes, the gate, we haven't talked about noise gate yet. It's switched to soft, so on soft you don't hear anything. Let's show it to the camera. Here's our noise gate switch. I can switch it actually off because we are not noisy anyhow. This cable is also a bit short. Let's put the guitar straight into the input, not using the switcher. Actually, today I don't need the switcher. We are not comparing any of the other amps. It's more about to understand what's going on with the Amp One. So here's like, let's use a high gain tone. This is high gain all the way up. Put it to soft and here we go in. You can hear it is triggered, but this is like guitar on one. And this is how sensitive it is, you know, it's like, put it to the metal side so we can hear how well attacky that gate can be. Yeah, so all possible here. And the trigger comes from the input and the output of the preamp stage. So we have like two information that the gate is always perfectly adjusted to the channels, leaving as much true signal through without cutting anything that is not wanted. So not everybody raves about our gate here. I mean, for me, the classic guy, put it simply on soft and you're fine. If you're a metal guy, use it on metal. And if you have an iridium, you can even switch with a reverb switch from metal to soft. So when the reverb is engaged on the iridium, then the gate switches automatically to soft, which makes it nice to let your solo notes ring and play softly. Sometimes metal guys do that as well. Well, anyway, some more questions here. What is this? Googler. Uh-huh. Can I have the link to the backing track from the beginning? Yeah, let me have a quick look. I was lazy today. I used BB King, The Thrill Is Gone. It's called The Best Studio Backing Track B Minor. You will find it on YouTube. Super easy one. Here we go. Maybe you can screen this a little bit bigger. Yeah. Doesn't matter. You'll find it on YouTube. BB King, The Thrill Is Gone. It's such a great classic. Yeah. Ah, Reflection. Nothing special. Okay, I hope we get no copyright things, because I didn't play BB King. I just used that kind of nice backing track. And thanks to the guy. Let's make some advertising for the guy who did it. Who is it? Max Marconi. So, greetings to Max Marconi, who created that beautiful backing track. Well, it's very tasteful and it's mixed right. Yeah, I liked it. You know, I was looking for a backing track and I thought, one of my songs? No, because I wanted to be like in one world. I mean, this kind of cycles all around the same way. There's not much happening in the composition, which is great to show sounds and compare sounds. And this is why I chose this one today. Okay, this was the backing track question. George, how would I go about getting the most clean headroom from Amp 1 without it distorting too much? Very good question. Let's do it for you. Clean headroom is about finding no breakup. Okay, usually it's nice to have an amp breaking up, because that's kind of where the overtone and the dirt comes in the world, and you don't want that breakup, which is fair enough. Sometimes you want that clean, really clean tone. And you know, there's guys like Corey Wong, who is Mr. Clean Master, and he plays a lot like straight into a mixing console, not even using amps. And he's pretty funky. So sometimes clean is a good choice. So what was the question? How would I go about getting a most clean headroom from the M1 without breaking up? First is set the master higher than 5, because anything lower than 5 will not give you headroom. Then the power amp is kind of too much reduced. Actually, I would think about 7-ish or 8 even as a starting. Let's put it on 7. So then we start with the clean volume on 0. No tone, okay? No breakup. Dead. So this is like we are on 1. I mean, that's dead clean. But for me, it's a bit boring. Okay, so I give it a 2. I'm using that guitar as an example. I would probably do different things with different guitars, but let's crank it another 1, 2, 3. To me, that's still that clean. I can't hear the breakup yet. We have to be fair when we crank more to 4. Reduce the master volume so we don't cheat ourselves too much. Five. Reduce master. Well, now my question starts, how much treble do I want? And we go back for the beginning of this episode where I explained the treble bleed. And now at 5, you know, there's only just a little bit. The higher I get, the less of that extra treble I get for my clean volume. So I make sure that I put my clean tone now on full, which sounds like that. Ah, there is my high end. Sounds still clean to me. I mean, I can dig in like crazy. Doesn't matter. Give it a 6. Give it a 7. Here I can hear the dirt. Okay. So with this guitar, from what I hear now with my little monitors, that's the sweet spot for me now. So, next thing I would do is I would try what the boost can do for me. Go back for 0 and see how that feels. No boost. So I like the clack thing. No boost. Both sounds are great. Well, there's my 2 offers to you. And as you could see, no magic, just dial in. If it's too clanky now for you, you can still go back with the clean tone here, like in the middle. Or all the way down to make it warm. But I think we like that spankiness. At least, let's put it on 3 o'clock, not all the way up, but like here. And some boost. Why am I excited about a boost? That boost is an extra stage that gives me sustain. It's not a compressor, but the stage has a compressing element to it. And it's kind of, you know, we want that clean tone, but we don't want that boring clean tone. So we are excited about the overtones coming from it, and we are excited about some little compression. Of course, you can use a compressor pedal like this MXR Dynacomp or the Yellow Comp or whatever compressor, to keep the signal always in the clean range of the clean channel on your amp 1. That helps too. But today I didn't want to go pedals. I just wanted to be pure about amp 1 to show you, you know, the extra layer of options that you normally would not think of. You plug in an amp, you feel the amp, you play the amp, and you decide the first minute, I like it, I don't like it. And that's fair enough. This is how we are. If we eat a steak, for instance, the first bite tells us, oh, it's salty, or it's boring, or it's not bloody enough, or it's too well done, or whatever taste we have. That's a personal taste thing. And we are human beings. We are very, very sensitive to that, how it feels, how it sounds. And so that's all okay. I mean, it's, you know, some guy go to the same restaurant. Let's keep that thing with the steak going. And, you know, it's the same cow, it's the same animal, it's the same bloody steak. But one guy likes his steak well done, and the next wants it bloody rare, you know? So, and there's nothing wrong about it. It's a, and the one guy takes a lot of salt and pepper, and the next guy that just wants it pure. And whatever your senses, your taste is, you are striving to get to that ultimate personal tone, which is, in the end, the thing that connects with you. Me being an amp designer, I can only offer options to get there. And, you know, what I'm doing today is I try to show you stuff that you probably don't think of when you plug into an amp one at first glance. I made the experience that certain users call me up 1 year later and say, man, I put the treble down to whatever, blah, 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 and I'm in heaven. And it's like, okay, it's from here to there. But, you know, if that is the magic sweet spot for them, it's fine. I found my sweet spots with my amp one, but I know it probably best. And but I find some other tones inspired by other players once in a while. Like, oh man, you're doing this. And I go, I should be doing that as well. And this is today's episode. Anyway, this was the clean question here. Classic channel is awesome. Yeah, thank you. Ah, Max Karten. Greetings to Belgium. So you're not playing the soccer game today. David Matei. Hi, Thomas. Which button was for the 50-watt mode and the sound different compares to the 100-watt? Very easy. If I switch off the amp, press and hold this button, which is usually toggling between clean and overdrive, it switches the amp to 50 watts. And when I do the same thing again, it switches back to 100 watts. And to access the low gain mode, where I could actually program all that stuff into the channels that I showed you, to recall that, you would press and hold the boost button. It will memorize the whole thing, so you only have to do that once. But that's the switch to go there. And if you want to put it back to full gain, you would simply press that again and switch it on. So that's that thing. And the third switch here, which is the reverse switch, will recall the preset mode, where you can have three settings, your three favorite settings on the three internal foot switches. But that's all in the manual, guys. The manual is worth reading again. And if you don't have enough from the manual, there's even FAQs on our website. And if you are beyond those FAQs, you can even go to the expert mode. And on the expert mode, which is also on our website, you go to the product, you go to Amp One, and there's a little thing that says expert mode. There you find extra videos where I show you how to program the sounds into your Amp One. So you do whatever you like, and then you don't even need the remote anymore. It's all in there. So you can kind of tune the Amp One to your personal taste, and then it's all in this little box here. So that was my idea. Okay, back to the questions here. The question was about what is the sound difference? Well, 100 watts is more headroom, and more headroom means more attack. And it's like a 50 watt or 100 watt Marshall. The 50 watt is kind of sweeter in a way, because it's kind of starts to compress earlier, and that's kind of more a singing quality. But to be honest, you know, some nasty Marshalls you can only stand, or you can only like if they are not too harsh. My good old Thomas Marshall from 1967 is a 100 watt Marshall, and I like it at any volume because that's a warm amplifier. And, you know, some of the early 70s, they are too bright for me, especially with the Strat. So the 100 watts from that period is not my taste. And as I was inspired by the more warmer amps, the amp one already is kind of warm. So the 50 watt for me is not really needed. It's another thing you can do with that. But again, it's a matter of taste. My taste is standard 100 watts, warm headroom, have the preamp saturation going, put the master on 5 to 6. That's my sweet spot where I'm allowed to play live. If you're only allowed to play on 4, maybe you should try out the 50 watts. Maybe that's giving you that extra creaminess and your sweet spot. A personal thing. Try it out. Okay, next question here. Does the first edition of Amp One have a low power mode too? The amp itself has no low power. Wait, I think it has low power. Man, I forgot about. I have done 3 amps and I forgot about. I have to look it up. Low power mode. I think it has a low power mode. Yes, but it does definitely not have a low gain mode. The low gain mode comes with the Mercury edition and the Iridium edition, so the later versions. Low power was there, I think. Fuck, I need to read the manual as well. If somebody knows, put it in the comments. Now is the time to be Mr. Professor knows more than the designer. Do you need an investor for the next version? Well, if you have too much money, I wouldn't mind to have some money in the bank so we can go for anything. So far, Blue Guitar is only 100% founded and financed with my own money. I have nobody on this planet that tells me what I'm doing. I burn my own money. Everything I own as a musician is in this company, and I don't need any more money because that makes me happy. If I have an investor, if I had an investor, they probably go and think, we give this money and then we want to make decisions. No good with Blue Guitar, because Blue Guitar is about 100%. If you have money and if you don't need it, put it in my bank. I will use it. I even sign off that I only use it for Blue Guitar products. It's not used for my private drinks, holidays or whatever. So if you have too much money, why not? Write me an email. I give you my back, the company's bank account. Okay, and I promise you nobody will go on vacation of that. Okay, next question here. I love both of the amps. Okay, cool. Next one is also, if you're familiar with the classic Mark II C plus, yeah, John Petrucci style tones, any tips or tricks that you found to get closer to those rhythm and lead tones? Actually, that's a very, very, very good topic. I wish I had one of those Mark II C pluses here to actually do this with my AB switcher. I remember those amps because, of course, once in a while I plug into one when I see one in a music store, which I haven't seen because of COVID. Nobody has seen any music stores, or it's a weird time. So I know those amps a bit. And what's the tip? Basically, most Mesas are kind of focused amps, more or less focused, and you can get there with the Amp One, especially if you are into the high gain territory, by cascading the stuff with the boost and the gain. And then don't go to 10, because that's kind of my vintage muddiness all the time, where the Hendrix lives. And you want to go probably to 7, put the boost also, depending on the guitar, maybe also kind of 3 o'clock, which equals 7, something like this. Don't go to maximum. Just stay below that line where it starts to be too broad, too vintagey. There's the, just dial back from 10 till you find the most definition. Actually, that's a good thing in general. If you want more definition, go to a maximum and dial back from 10. The other thing is you can dial up from 0, but if you're talking high gain sounds, this takes too long. So dial back from 10 is the thing. And have cascading things like the boost and the channel. And of course, high gain is in the amp 1 on the modern channel already, which is a cascaded preamp stage design. That's if somebody here in the Saarland has a Mark II C plus, hey, give me a call. I would love to have it here in the video studio and we do it. If not, I have a look, and once I have found one, I will do it. And by the way, I already spotted somebody that has a dumbbell. So one day you hear a dumbbell versus what we've got here. And I'm excited to do that because these amps are so expensive. I can't wait to make the challenge. Okay, next. Jens Friedrich Gude Thomas. Oh, very German. Gude is from Frankfurt area. Describe your drink. Again, okay. If you mind, greetings from Hesse. Yeah, okay. So, what's my drink? This is called... it's a Cina. Cina is a Italian artichoke, little liquor, not too heavy, 10% alcohol or 8 or something. And it's tons of sparkling water, like you fill it up 80-90% with sparkling water. You put a lot of lemon into it to make it sour, and then fill it up with that nice Italian artichoke. And that's it. Delicious. A typical summer drink. Good hint. It's a little bit bitter, but the mixture of the high end, I would call it high end, which is the lemon. You know, the lemon is the sparkling high end combined with that mids from that artichokes, you know. It equals my tone. If you listen to my tone, you know what this kind of drink can taste like. Yeah. Okay. Where are we? If you have too much money, I can... Yeah. How would you like outcome of your genies? What's that? What I would like to outcome your... I don't get it. Genius. Ah, okay. You are the genius. Well, I'm not a genius. I do my thing, and I'm pretty. I hope I can tell you I'm pretty consequent with what I'm doing. You know, not being controlled by other people. And I wanted that because I have a vision of what I want for myself and for me and for you, and that makes sense in my head, and that's my dream. And that's all in Blue Guitar and my music. And I can't think of anything better than that besides having my push bike rides in the sun. That's the only thing I'm missing. Today was a nice and sunny day. I would have, usually I would do that at that time of day, you know, when it's nice and sunset. Yeah, it's cool. That's something I really enjoy. That's basically all I need. And yeah, I have a car, I have a bike, I have food, I have a good drink. That's all I need. Okay, what else? Pooh Ninja. I was gone for a minute. Does the gate trigger from the input and signal before? It is triggered from the input signal, sure. The gate, we are talking again. And it's triggered from the output of the preamps. So it's adjusted to that. So the gate knows what preamp it's using or is being used. And of course, it's super sensitive from the input trigger. Put it in easy word. the gate simply works. Nobody has ever complained about the gate. Nobody. And people like to complain about stuff. Okay? Lemon. Uh-huh. Lemon is important, yeah. But, you know, just the lemon alone in the drink is not the thing. It's the blend of lemon and chinar. C-Y-N-A-R. I'm not sponsored by anybody. I just buy the drinks. It's 10 euros and it lasts forever because I only have a little sip of that to make the nice blends of, you know, both of the high end and the mid range. Okay, any suggestions on how to balance a clean tone against a high gain tone with more extreme EQ settings? For example, bass on 2 or something, it makes it tougher to dial in the clean channel. Ah, that's a good point. If we are talking about matching tones, I always put it that way. There's a frequency spectrum that you send with your guitar. And these, you know, frequencies, they have a place in the mix. And if one sound fits very well in the mix, let's say it's your overdrive tone, your clean tone should be matched to that sound that works in the mix. And if you take away all the other instruments, probably your clean tone doesn't sound that exciting anymore. But all it, what counts is how does the sound works in the mix. And that's the secret how to match sounds in multi-channel amplifiers, which Amp 1 is one four is a four-channel multi-channel amplifier. And what are the tips? Well, I already mentioned, don't forget the mids when you play clean tones. Also, don't forget the mids when you play overdrive tones. But the amount of mids and the frequencies where the mids are, they should be similar, because if there are other instruments, if you have two instruments playing at the same frequencies too much, you have like a rumble or honky horn, whatever sound on stage. It's weird. And the PA guy, if he's a good guy, tries to mix, to get that frequency out of the way. And that is kind of doing the job that you actually should be doing. If you have a great band like AC/DC, Led Zeppelin or Deep Purple, even without a PA, the band sounds great because they created their band sound in the rehearsal room because they were listening to the other instruments in the room. And this is where you find the right settings. And you can do similar stuff with backing tracks. So you simply have a backing track and you have you play the backing track and then you adjust the knobs and you will find out what actually works. If you stop the backing track, you listen to something, oh, maybe it's not as good as this one, but there's the truth. If you play with other musicians, you have to sound good with other musicians. It's not about sounding good alone. So experience is, it's all, for me, it's all my experience is that the high end needs to be at the right place, the mids have to be at the right place, and the bass has to be at the right place. Okay, this is so general, nobody can do anything with that, but think of these three layers in frequencies and maybe just listen to that one aspect and think about your high end. Is the high end nice? Does it compete with the cymbals? Or are the cymbals of the drums kind of there and your guitar is slightly at a different place in the mix? And if so, that's great. But if everybody plays in the same frequency range, it sounds not great. And I said that before, AC/DC sounds so great because the guitars are so loud and everybody else is around, mixed around the guitars. The bass drum is lower than the guitars. The bass is lower than the guitars. Even the snare drum is lower than the guitars and the snare, Teppich, what's the English word, whatever, bzz, the high-end stuff is higher than the guitars. That's the trick. So there is kind of a big frequency hole in the middle, and that's all for the guitars. And this is why it sounds so great. And even the vocals are higher than the guitar. Great. I mean, these guys, they put it to the essence of rock and roll. It's perfect. It's a perfect example for arranging and mixing stuff. If you listen to the Black Album or, you know, Back in Black and all that stuff, it's simply great. Yeah, they know what they are doing. Okay. Free food. Okay, greetings from Northern Florida. Florida, hey, Mercury Edition is amazing, even with neighbors agree. The neighbors agree because you play so loud or because the tone is so nice? Yeah, actually, last year I was in Florida. I enjoyed it very much. Of course, I was in Miami, but I also was at Fort Myers. If anyone knows where that is, beautiful place to make a vacation. Might go back there. Yeah. So maybe we meet in Florida next year after Winter Nam. Okay. And I hear some mercury in the garden of somebody in Florida. And by the way, this famous German comedian Otto Walkes, he also has one home in Florida. Where are we? Okay, have a little problem in the patient's room with band, a practice room. When dialing in the reverb, I got feedback problems. If I turn it off, of course, it stops. But when I want reverb in my tone, it's difficult. Uh-huh. So the first thing is the reverb on the Amp 1 is a digital reverb. So there is no real reverb tank that could feedback. You know, the good old spring reverb from your Fender Twin or whatever, classic Acoustronics. The best one is the three spring Acoustronics reverb tank in a tube driven design, blah blah blah, all good. They can feedback, and they are actually packed so that the sound waves from the speaker don't go straight into the springs, and that could create a feedback loop to block that. But on the Amp 1, that's not the case. So if you have anything feedbacking from that, that tells me something might be wrong in your setup, because the reverb is not feedbacking itself. I show you. What sound do we have? Maybe this one. So this is how it is. This is how an Amp 1 sounds, and this is how every Amp 1 reverb sounds. They are all the same. They all use the same algorithm. They all have the same parameters. There's a little secret. If you open the amp, you can have some other sounds as well, but don't do it. This one is the best. There's a springier one. But I decided this one is the one that we all should use. And there's no feedback. So if there's feedback, it must come from something else. Maybe because the reverb tail creates a signal that comes back to your pickups, or there's something wrong with your pedal board, that there's like electromagnetic stuff going on. You should check that. And to check that, you should isolate it. Have just the guitar, the amp, and your speaker. Double check if there is any feedback. and it shouldn't have that feedback. If there's already feedback, change the guitar. I mean, the speaker is not making the feedback, so it's and I'm sure it's not the amp. So then check the guitar. And then I'm pretty sure you will find a guitar that is not doing the feedback and the amp and the speaker is the same. Then bring in the next component on your pedal board or on your setup and check if that is making any of these noises. So yeah, that's the way how to analyze faulties or problems. You have to go back to the bare starting point. Put everything out of the signal path. Just have the elements, guitar, amp, speaker. And then you go from there. Okay. Dave Byron, rocking Fort Myers. This is where I was. Yeah. Okay. Why I agree, but spend a lot of time with modern on pre at 2.5 master at 7 niche and ride my guitar volume and tone cleanish to roaring. Well, there's nothing wrong about that. You know, it's all cool. There's so many. This is my point. There's so many recipes for your personal taste. I just try to help you in case you haven't found your sweet spot. So I try to be an inspiration, like try to do other settings. And whatever is your setting, hey, it's art. We can do whatever. We can play Jimi Hendrix and play it the other way around if you can. I can't. I totally suck on doing it. So it's, yeah, this is how it is. Otto is a superhero now. Yes. Well, Otto was a superhero in my youth. I mean, me and my sister, we had so much fun on Otto, you know. Mutti, ich mag mein Brechmittel nicht essen. Wie, du magst dein Brechmittel nicht essen? It's unbelievable. Yeah. So, okay, must be something else. Thanks. What else do we have here? Seitenschuft. Maybe the feedback comes from the loop, yeah? If you put, for instance, a drive in the loop, the reverb will go to feedback. If you experience that, that's possible. I mean, the amp is designed to be totally stable, which it is, but if you exceed certain levels, then you run into problems. That's just like a car. I mean, if there is a way how to increase the level internally, which you can do in the loop, because the loop is in between the preamp and the power amp, and if you boost it a certain amount, it's never a problem. But then you will drive the nanotube and then the gain gets to a level where everything will kind of start to oscillate and stuff. So there is a physical limitation for gain or volume in circuits. So you have to be aware of that. And that's nothing that comes with blue guitar. That's something that goes with any amp, with any pedal. You know, stuff is never endless. You can go to extremes, yes, and if you have a good design, you can have tons of stuff without having too many side effects, which I believe we do. Even though we have such a small housing and having critical circuits with tons of gain, and you know, there's the input and there's your output, the speaker is this far apart, but the design is so clean. That it is not causing problems. Everybody working on blue guitar products is very experienced. I'm only choosing guys that had feedbacks in their past and don't do design doing that, you know? So I'm too old to work with people that have no real knowledge. I'm not impressed about, you know, it's either killer or I don't need it, you know? Anyway, back to the questions. Man, today we have many questions. What is this? Mr. Norboton. Okay. Can you make an M1 which just do the tri-axis and Mark 5 sounds? I used to have a tri-axis Mesa Boogie sometimes in the 90s. I think I sold it. I still have that rack with my VS250. Actually, that's a good point. I have to open my rack again and see if it's still there or if it's gone. I think it's gone because, you know, I might have sold it. But the Tri-Axis was also a nice preamp back then. One rack space, Mesa Boogie, all programmable. Nice one. Jens Friedrich again. The loop is the only comp which is off and a delay. Wait a minute. In the loop, the only comp which is off and a delay. I don't get that. Doesn't matter. nothing. That's a good one. Nothing like playing an acoustic. Sure. Hey. no cables, no speakers, no pedals. That's something I also enjoy. I sometimes play my electric acoustically, and it's cool. And it's actually good to practice that too, because then the amp enhances things, which inspires you and makes you play in a different way, which is good. But on the other hand, it's good to have a bare, clean tone, just like the strings by itself, and monitor what you are actually doing. You know, without the gain and stuff, or just like the strings as they are with no amp. So I'm all about, you know, these different extremes. Why? Because in every situation and every different situation, you feel different. And that makes me think about what I'm doing. It's like having a mirror from the other side. It's like, oh, well, I totally look shit from the other side. Maybe I should change something here. And so is it when you play when you play your overdrive licks without overdrive. It's like maybe you suck and you didn't know. You will find out when you have no overdrive. And that helped me. So, and let's go back to the acoustic question. On the one hand, it's great to have that. And on the other hand, it's great to have all that gain that makes you feel like a rock, like a guitar hero, even with no efforts at all. So it's kind of legato playing all the way through. And it sounds cool. You can benefit from both, you know. Once you've been there with all the gain, at least your left hand is doing the moves already right, and then you can work on the right hand to get the energy behind the strings with your picking hand. Yeah, so both extremes are very helpful. Next, oh my god, we have... I find it amazing all the available sounds which are available in the M1. I use mine kind of as a dirty pedal platform on vintage channel with the boost active. Yeah, I mean, there are so many ways how to use the M1. And like, I think it's 3 episodes ago, I had Mick Taylor from That Pedal Show. You know, That Pedal Show from the UK. I'm a fan of their program, and I've been on their program, I think, twice already.
great guys, Dan and Mick, and they have the clean amp as a reference. And so if it's not a perfectly nice clean amp, the pedals don't sound right. That's their world, and I love it because they are so fanatic about it in a way, and so puristic about it. It totally makes sense. This is kind of coming from the cleanish Fendery world, using different pedals, and then open into this universe of tones that you will get from that kind of platform with pedals. And that's that pedal show. Me is more, see all these Marshalls, and I'm using them all kind of driven, and then still use pedals with these amps. That's my background. I do understand the Fender clean background, and I worked with that too, but I spent more time in that kind of dirty world, enhancing the dirty, raunchy Marshall tones with extra pedals. And that's the same like you are doing. And yeah, that's another concept. It's one of many concepts that actually make sense to me a lot. Okay, next. Then I bring in a treble booster, yeah, or a Germanium fuzz, and use the guitar volume. I've done episodes on that topic as well. I can play the vintage channel with something like that and don't even use clean anymore. And it's all there. You know, that's old school. This is the way Rory Gallagher played. This is everybody, Queen, and they didn't have multi-channel amps. They had one amp, and they relied on that one amp, and then they had a few pedals with that. And if it was more like a vintage amp, a treble booster is magic. And the other day I was in the studio. I recorded also with Amp One for a friend of mine, and I used the clean channel with my Red, whatever, Effectrode boost. Man, what a tone. It was that perfect combination for that song. Sounds huge, and yeah, it's all good. It's kind of that concept. And used, of course, the volume control, because that's my thing too. And that combination, I found a magic combination in the clean at 10 and boosted, squashed that to death with that tube booster, which was not overdriving. It was simply giving you the extra gain needed, but perfect. And then controlled with the volume, I could dial from clean to massive gain on the guitar with one tone, just a pure signature I could put on that track. Maybe I will play this for you when it's mixed. Okay, wow. Next question. Are you a father? Do you have kids playing instruments? Sorry, personal question. No, I'm not a father, but my sister has kids. So I have a niece and a nephew. And some people might have seen my nephew, who plays also a white Strat. How comes? Well, the uncle has a white Strat, and when he started to pick up an instrument, there was a white Strat in the house. And it's fun, but on the other hand, it's also fun to be free in a way. Sometimes I think, yeah, I could be a father, but on the other hand, I'm happy that my sister did the dirty work and I'm the uncle, which is fine. Fair enough. I'm pretty happy like things are, but it's fun to see how young people react for instruments, or how they grow up and how do they develop their own personality as a person and also on the instrument. I think it's something. But my life is so exciting. Too much things, too many things. So I forgot to do that. Anyway. Next one. If someone is searching for a project perfect reverb. Where was the line? I have looked to the Bricast TM7 hardware. Really expensive, in German Schweineteuer, but it is worth it every penny. Okay, so somebody says, check out the Bricast TM7. It's in the comment. Reverb. Yeah, there are some killer reverbs. I always rave about my private Lexicon plate reverb in the pedal from Digitech. Cheap. You get them so cheap, but they're so good for that money. And that's if I want that super high-end quality reverb in a pedal. So I'm sorted. And if I want that real plate reverb, I have two original EMT plate reverbs. I borrowed to some friend of mine in studios, but since I moved to my house here, which is the new studio, if my girlfriend allows me, I don't tell her. One day there's my plate reverb next door, and then I have the real deal EMT 140 plate reverb. I have one with tube driven, and I have one with stereo transistor driven, so I can do the whole history on plate reverbs from the 60s to the 80s, from original Van Halen. Yeah, it's all there. And you can hear that reverb on my records, because even though if I'm not able to have that reverb in the studio, I simply have my dry guitar track. I go to my friend's studio and I record just the wet signal from the reverb only, and use that reverb tracks stereo in the studio where I do the mixing, being it here at home or in some other studio. So, but the real deal mechanic plate reverb is something that is special to me. Okay. Hi, Thomas. Tell us about your pick choice. Yes, my pick choice. I'm having this ultra heavy, as you can hear, 2 millimeter kind of triangle shaped picks that are Hendrix style. And on the other hand, I have my home based picks. These are the ones. This one is the Blackmore style home plates, and this is I grew up with these picks because I'm a big Ritchie Blackmore fan. And you know, some people talk about slanted pick angling, like upwards, downwards, and stuff like that. And this weird shape, you can actually play 90 degrees and it works. And I developed my technique with these picks, not even thinking about that way, you know, pick slanting or anything. I just played and it worked. You know, it's like, don't ask me what I'm doing. It's like, yeah, put a camera there, and I'm sure it's economy picking like crazy, because I pick a lot. It's not like I'm a lazy guy and do hammer-ons all the time and not do picking, but it's like Yngwie, I'm not doing many movements. You know, I'm a lazy. But that way I can still be fast and I have a lot of dynamic. Thank you. good Aldi Miola. You can learn that stuff from it. So this was the home plate, which you can actually buy from the Blue Guitar homepage. And hey, talking about advertising, we have t-shirts. This beautiful Amp1 t-shirt, which is the Amp1 t-shirt. We have the One t-shirt. And we have the one that I put under the remote, which is the Academy of Tone t-shirt. And so t-shirts and more t-shirts. Summertime needs t-shirts. So I put it back under here. Anyway, back to my triangle pick. This one I played for so long, the edges are gone. And this is why what I love. If I play the same pick like this one with fresh edges, it's like... Maybe you hear it, I can hear it, it doesn't sound as good. The one with the round edges. It's boring. It's the same pick, it's just not played enough. Trust me, guitars, picks, and all that shit needs to be played. We can buy it new, but it's like shoes. Wear them, and just for me, shortly before they fall apart, that's where the feet feel the best. And same thing with the picks. When my picks, when I play them for 2 years with all the three, you know, tips here, and everything is kind of rounded for me playing it, then it's rounded at the right spot. You know, it's like if somebody else would play with that pick, he would have the pick would have a different shape. So sometimes it matches my thing and sometimes it doesn't. You know, when I play with other colleagues, it's sometimes we swap picks, and then there are some magic moments where I think, man, your pick is killer. But this is like, yeah. And then I have the same pick, let's call it a whatever, Jazz 3. And if it's used by somebody else, like, ugh, I'm not getting anything out of that. So that's the pick thing. Okay. Oh, where are we? Picks. So Jens Friedrich again. Me again. Oh, yeah. Can you tell us a really good reason why you buy another amp than the Amp1? It depends on what you want. You know, to be honest, the Amp1 is a very versatile amp, and it does its thing, and it does a lot. I would think there's many amps that you don't need anymore because it's all in there and without any compromise. But there are still amps that are different and that maybe make you happy, and then you should buy them. It's just like another guitar. I mean, there's nothing wrong about other products, and there's nothing wrong about other amps. Which one? I'm waiting for the Dumble to see if I would buy it. Actually, when I had a Dumble in my hands 20 years ago, I felt like I wouldn't buy that amp because it was not my taste. But after 20 years, I probably reconsider my thinking with my new knowledge. Let's see. I'm excited to do that one day. And but that's the other way of thinking. With the Amp1, you can do so many things. And as I tried to tell you today, there's even more than you think. And you get there. And once you, when you're there and when you connect with the amp, that's your amp. And I'm happy if it's with the Amp1. But I'm also happy if somebody plays a, you name it, whatever, Buchner or Friedman or whatever amp. If somebody is happy with an amp, then he starts to make good music. And this is what it's about. And if he hasn't found the right settings on the M1, maybe I should do another episode or invite him personally. And then he can lug around a lot less with such a small amp, having an easy life. But up until that time, carry your whatever favorite amp and be happy with that. It's all good. Okay. So, the sealer go to 5,000 reverb. Okay. $5,000 reverb. Briscati. Okay. Would you spend $5,000 on a reverb? 5,000. Man. I have no idea. I wouldn't probably do that. 5,000. Maybe on a vintage Strat. But they cost 15,000. you know, I don't care. Okay, next question. Hi, Thomas. Can you tell us about to get a Santana sound with langsam sustain? Ah, somebody has... Santana. Hey, talking about Santana, there's different time periods in Santana. One is the early days, where he played the modded Fenders and the Mesa Boogie Mark 1s. And then there's the later days where he used different stuff. And Santana is about mids. So you have to get mids and use the tone control on the guitar to get the peak away. You know, the tone control of the guitar mellows the guitar pickup. I give you an example. Let me use that sound here. So this is my neck pickup. If I want that honk mids, I would go for the middle pickup and reduce the tone a touch. So this is how you get in that kind of territory, now using the Strat, but with whatever Gibson guitar or humbucker, you come much easier to that point. And the other trick about a Santana tone is focusing the mids, but also focusing on that weird but so special phrasing. Because Carlos came from the background being a violin player, so he holds the pick between these two fingers, not like these two fingers, and that kind of makes a different phrasing, and this is where it comes from. But of course we all want to sound like that without being too much Santana, so we have to help ourselves using the boost, increasing the mids. But try out to use the tone, not all the way down, but a touch maybe. See what's in there for you to get to the Santana mid-focused tone. Maybe use a Tube Screamer if you have something that also a device that can help to focus mids. Or you can use an EQ like this 7-10 band EQ, whatever, and... there's many options how to get to the mid focus.
Mm-hmm.
this was the bridge pickup with no tone control. So you hear that is not Santana. And then, you know, just from switching. That's maybe a bit extreme, but. Tone all the way up. Slightly closed. Yeah, so that's the concept to get to Santana tones. I need those t-shirts. Yeah, that's good. Some people wonder how I can wear the same t-shirt all day. I have people in my family that think he only owns one t-shirt. The secret is very simple. I'm a lazy guy. You know, there's one pile of t-shirts with the one, and then there's a smaller pile with the other t-shirts. But I'm so happy with my one. I'm wearing it every day, even though when I'm not on live streams. My girlfriend hates it once in a while, but sometimes she says, oh, it's okay. And actually, she was wearing one of those too when she was freezing. Anyway, okay, t-shirt. Can you relate? I feel like also picks I keep using for a different genres turn feeling differently too. Yeah. Okay. Using picks for different genres and how you treat them, it is placebo. No, it is. If it's actually there, it's. I totally agree. If you have a pick and you play certain music or a certain style with it, it connects in a way, and it's kind of matches. It matches your attack. It matches your playing, and then it is kind of a better connection with the instrument. And this is all we want. We want the best connection, to have nothing in between our feel and the idea and what comes out of the speaker. The rest is doesn't matter what brand or whatever. It is about optimizing that. And if your pick is, if you connect with the pick because you played it, it's played in, so to speak, it helps. And that's my experience as well. So I like that used stuff a bit more. Okay, man, I think, oh, we have already 2 hours, 21 minutes. So we had a long episode. We had finally some time to talk with the live stream, with all your questions here. I'm very happy about that relaxed episode, and I hope you had some nice little inputs and I could tell you or maybe you are inspired to try out some other things as well, and you discover something that you probably haven't tried out yet. So if you have more things, write it in the comments below, and yeah, we'll talk about that. I have no clue who was winning the game. The only thing I know is England will hopefully not play again next, so we have Rich again here in the studio and I can share the studio with him. So see you all next week, same place. Ciao, ciao, bye-bye. All the best. See you. Bye.